Welcome to Serious Business. There's no more serious business than recovering your sanity. That is the most serious business. This world here, what's the best way to describe this world? What is the best way to describe this world situation? The best way to describe it that I can come up with, the best way to describe this world is no description. No description. So, once again, welcome to the video. What we're trying to do here in this world is to describe the indescribable. What is a description but a structure, right? And what we are has no structure at all. So how can we describe no structure? How's that possible? Can't do it. Cannot do it. The more we try, the more ridiculous it gets. And it's gotten very ridiculous. This world and bodies, that's completely ridiculous. Utterly bizarre. Totally bizarre. This world is, if we were to know reality and what we truly are, and look and really know that, looking at this world, it would just be the most bizarre, silly ridiculousness possible. And yet we take this all seriously. And it's getting more ridiculous all the time. The more we try to define what we are, the more ridiculous it all becomes, the more farcical it becomes, the more confusing it all becomes. So we are very avidly working towards being willing to experience what we are free of definition, or at least perhaps experience just the final definition, which is a non-definition. But even a non-definition is relative to definition, isn't it? So as I say, supernature would be like no process. It's like a non-definition of the world. It's a way to non-define the world, but you're still referencing what it is that you're non-defining, you're not defining. So, with all that in mind, fire the world, fire the culture, cosmic corporate culture, terminate their employment. Say, you're not working for me anymore. Tell this attempt to define what we are. You're not working for me anymore. So the best description of this world is no description. Now, the best description of this world is no description. No description. That describes the world. No description. And this is a mind melter, isn't it? Because it enables us to set the world down. We set it down by describing it as no description. I didn't say it's indescribable. I said no description. It doesn't deserve a description at all, does it? The attempt to describe what we are doesn't deserve any description at all. Not even a negative one. Doesn't deserve any description. It's completely ridiculous and beyond that. So no description. So what is this world we're experiencing? It's an attempt to define, to describe what we are. This is a way of looking at it. And we cannot be described or defined at all. So there's no description of us that comes close, really. There's no description that actually comes close. If what we are is no structure, well, how can any structure actually come close to that? Can't really, can it? But you can have a structure that, relative to other structure, seems to be without definition or structure, relatively so. And then this is how we solve our continuity fear. But ultimately, there is no description of pure absolute freedom that makes the slightest bit of sense whatsoever. So one description is just as utterly absurd as another. Still raining here in California. But it's about to stop. So the more the world we engage in trying to define what we are, the more farcical it becomes, the more absurd it becomes, actually. The more we try to define what is pure freedom has no structure. It has no definition. This is the open gate to no definition. The open gate to no definition. So what we do want to do is just sit there and experience this being in the ballpark, being close to no definition. No structure. Now, this may seem like confusion. It's not. See, this is very important. The ego will say it's confusion. Our defenses will say it's confusion. Our continuity fear will say, hey, that's confusion. I'm confused. But what you have to do is recognize spiritual, use your spiritual will to say, hey, this is my continuity fear speaking. And I have a better way of dealing with my continuity fear, which is to say, wow, this is wow. It's not confusion, it's wow. And I'm going to spend time full stop in this wow of no definition. Wow, no definition, no definition. What I am is no definition. And then you realize no definition is not confusion about what you are. Now, when we come into this world, we're told this is what you are. You are a what? You have a definition. You are defined. You have a structure. And so I remember going around feeling like I said, I don't know what I am. I really don't know what I am at all. I still don't. But we're told that we're supposed to know what we are. And meaning definition, structure-wise. And I didn't know, and I still don't know. And only now I'm saying, hey, that's okay. In fact, it's better than okay. That's great. But when you have the whole world telling you, you know, acting like they know what you are, do you know what you are? I know, you know, some everyone's saying, I know what you are, do you know what you are? I kept thinking, God, I don't know what I am. Well, I don't know what I am. So I feel very insecure, you know, and anxiety, depression, I don't know what I am. There is no what to I am at all. I don't have any what. I'm not anything at all. I have no structure. Spirit has no structure. There's no whatness or even awareness. Even awareness is a structure, isn't it? Space, right? So there's no time. No space, no process, no form to I am. So what we're doing is flipping the script here and when we say, who am I? Who am I? Meaning, what structure do I have? What structure do I have? Who am I? What is my structure? Where am I? Who am I? I don't know. I can't find myself. I can't find my structure. I can't find myself, meaning I can't find what I am. So I went on a desperate search trying to find what I am. Who am I? And I never found the answer to that, except that to know there is no who or what to absolute freedom. So we can call off the search. So it's not confusion, it's wowness. So this is what I'm saying. The way out of confusion is wowness, is full stop in the wow. Don't structure the wow. Spend some unstructured moments here. This is what we do in the videos, unstructured moments. I never know what I'm going to say. But the wow feeling is just a feeling like, wow, that it seems everything, I feel unstructured. I feel suddenly free of my beliefs. I feel I've stepped, you know, taken a big step, a breakthrough where I don't know who I am. Oh, that's good. I don't know what I am. Oh, that's great. Instead of feeling wrong about it, we feel absolutely right about it. I don't know where I am either. I have no idea where I am. I have no idea what I am. I have no idea who I am. Don't need any of those. So full stop in the wow is like wow. And just keep the mind steady there. So it doesn't feel like confusion when you turn it around this way. It's great. This is great. It's a little jittery. Don't try to structure the wow. This is then when you start falling into confusion and fear, is trying to structure the wow. Don't structure it. Because we're getting closer and closer just to experiencing ourselves as we are, as isness. Now this wowness is not sleepiness, unconsciousness or anything. It's alertness. We're alert. We're aware. We're aware that we're in this mood, a feeling of you know, much less structure. Like wow, I just sort of my belief in what I am is just gone. You know, wow, the belief in what I am, where I am, who I am, it's become very. Unreified, very unconcretized, very destructured, even not even thinking about structure. So the world has it completely backwards. This world that doesn't even deserve any description whatsoever has it completely backwards, totally upside down backwards. And of course, we know why, as we've said over and over. We all believe we need a structured I for some, you know, we believe that's our identity, we think. Without that, what identity do we have? Or there isn't any what to know. You know, people might say, well, you don't know what you are then. There is no what to know. Freedom. I am freedom. I am absolute freedom. All is absolute freedom. And they might might say, well, that's not structure, right? Of course, there is no such thing as structure, actually. You can't really truly know structure because it doesn't really and truly exist. World believes that it's getting closer and closer to knowing, you know, who they are, what they are. More and more body identification. So it feels like, hey, we're going to finally succeed. Succeed at what? Well, what they believe is co-reality. So this gets back to, well, you have to have a what in order to live in this supposed co-reality. And we're told that this is the new creation. This is God's, you know, God has designed this new co-reality, co-necessity, where we have both no structure and structure, both human and divine, in other words, both no structure and structure, and that we're supposed to, therefore now we're supposed to find out what we are, who we are, and this is our task here in this world. We were told this is why we came to this world. You know, so everybody's here to help you really go insane is what they are here for, actually. That's why I say, whoa, I don't like to hang around people too much, because everything they're doing, saying, is designed to help bring about insanity. So if you value sanity, it's like, whoa, I think I'll stay away. Let's go in a cave somewhere. And for many of us, the cave is our room, right? Go in our room for a while and just to stay in there. Wow. And of course, we believe that this is some necessity. There's no necessity to it. It's just we've just imagined a necessity, and then insisted that God authored this necessity, even though God did not. And it's not, we have no will power to change God's will and add to it. We cannot add to it. We cannot give it a new function. We're changing God's will, giving a new function. We cannot have God's will say, okay, well, now you're supposed to have two realities, two different realities, and that's going to be better than the just one, you see. So now you have no structure, the reality of no structure, absolute freedom, and here you have the reality of structure or non-freedom, and that this is supposed to be much more enjoyable if you just hang in there long enough. You hang in there long enough. And so we're all hanging in there, you know, as best we can, waiting for, when is this? Now, here's something to think about. It's very interesting today. This popped into my head. This may seem very speculative, but it's pretty amazing. I was shown years back, while my body was resting, the mind, the spirit was very much aware of being shown this like movie of the future, video of the future, like it was just unfolding. I was driving along and all these things were happening, and I was watching this like a movie, and ultimately I was shown something, and what I was shown was that all these flesh forms, similar to humanoid forms of various types, came to the surface of the world. Where from? Two places, from space and from under the earth, under the underground. And I saw there's all these people like coming up like termites out of the, you know, out of the ground, just coming up everywhere, all over the world, just people. So I said, wow, there's life forms living under the surface of the earth. And many people throughout history, the testimony of many is that they've met these subterranean dwellers, that there's a huge culture community under this earth, under the surface of the earth. And they're going to come to the surface at some point. I saw them like opening up, like openings in the earth that they just came out like climbing a stairway almost out, you know, from underground. It's like, wow. Well, then suddenly, just today, I said, wait a minute. You know, in the Bible, doesn't it say that in the end times and the tribulation times and the end of the world and all this kind of stuff, last judgment of God and all these things, they say, and the tombs will be opened up from, and the earth will, people will rise from the dead, all these people that were underground, buried in the ground, will become alive again. And so this is, you know, this is something St. Paul was being a Pharisee, a very strong belief in many of that time in the various sects of Judaism, believed that in the resurrection of the dead. This is actually a very strong belief in ancient times, and many people still believe it, that all those who, you know, that's why we have these Christian ceremonies, cemeteries, where people, bodies are buried, nice crypt, you know, or tomb, and they're supposed to be sleeping there, waiting for the resurrection of the dead. But I would say, just something came to me and said, you know what, the whoever saw this vision, was it St. John the of something, who, Patmos, or, I'm not sure exactly, you know, how this, the book of Revelations and this talk of, well, actually it was Pharisee teaching. Where did it come from? Well, it may very well have come from somehow viewing the future and seeing all these people coming out from underground. And they interpreted that as, the people who are in the ground are now, you know, came from where? They didn't understand people could live underground like this. So they assumed it was the dead who were in graves under the ground, climbing out of their graves. Okay. So this is where the idea of the resurrection of the dead came from. And it's not actually the resurrection of the dead. It is the actual coming to the surface of this planet of many, many, many subterranean dwellers. There have been quite a few actually have said there's a whole reptilian race underneath the planet of this earth, have been living there for a long time. And the ones that I saw come up were very odd, you know. It's like they're very like on steroids or something. They're totally into their bodies and their musculature and the shape and the form of their bodies. And you look at modern culture, how people are just getting more and more and more obsessed with sculpting their bodies. And I saw all these people were like, they look like the people in the comic books, like superheroes or something, coming out from under the underground. That's what I saw. I said, wow, these people are very odd. They're so into their physique, and yet culture is looking more and more that way. When will the resurrection of the dead, you know, what many believe is coming soon? It could be that those from underground might soon come above ground. That is very possible. At some point, I believe this will happen in the world, and so this is, you know, so this is the resurrection of the dead. I certainly don't believe all the bodies that have died in history are going to be reconstituted, and they're all going to walk upon the earth again. I don't believe that. I think a lot of those who have passed on have no interest in resurrecting their bodies to walk upon this earth, especially the saints. They think all the saints are going to be resurrected and walk this earth. I don't think the saints really want to do that. Have their body resurrected and walk this earth again. So it's more likely those from the underground dwellers will come to the surface. It's a massive amount of work going on underground, tunneling, making living space underground of this planet. In fact, living underground is actually very common in the cosmos. Very, very common. It's actually seen as superior. They look at surface dwellers as fools, actually, really. Subjected to all sorts of torments and troubles, you know, and throughout the cosmos, through the struggles of disempowerment that this universal dream goes through, so much stuff has happened that many have just said, hey, you know what, it's way safer to live underground than it is, you know, you're not subjected to all sorts of catastrophes and troubles of all sorts. And so they somehow have developed, you know, the technology to do that and adapted to it. So it's very possible, in fact likely, that there are quite a few dwellers beneath the surface of this planet, from various places throughout the cosmos, having different colonies here and different colonies there, under the surface of the ocean, you know, a lot of, you know, not on the surface of the planet at all. So there you go, that just popped into my head, and I thought it was worth passing on, that strange days are ahead of us. Strange days are ahead of us. Very strange days are ahead of us. We have a very strange situation going on in the world. And it's stressing people out. Stressing people out. We don't really know where are we being, you know, where are we being led to? What is this? What's going on? People are just like, I don't know. But it doesn't really feel right. It doesn't really feel right. So, the key to the times is to practice identity without a structure. Okay, practice identity without a structure, which is this wowism, full stop in the wow. Because like I say, I'm a wowist. I'm practicing wowism. I'm practicing full stop in the wow, which is practice experiencing identity, being, without structure. Or at least, you know, willingness to fuzzy structure, where the structure seems to be dissolving. And let's let it dissolve. I call this evaporating the continuity fear. Because continuity fear is what is clinging to structure, the belief in structure. So let the structure simply evaporate. And this is this wow. As the structure evaporates, wow. Don't turn to the mind, intellect, then you'll get confusion. So back off of that and the confusion will disappear. You're not trying to structure this experience of no structure. Just you're trying simply getting used to it, getting familiar with it. That's all. Nothing more than that. You don't have to be some sort of genius about explaining or structuring or describing. Just get familiar with no structure. Identity has no structure. Identity has no time. Identity has no place. Identity has no process. Identity has no form. It's interesting that it's nighttime here, and it's pitch dark. I can't see anything. The lights are going at me, and I'm surrounded by, I don't know where I am, you know, at all. There's no way to orient, really. So it's actually helpful. Maybe that's why some meditators spend time in caves. It's dark. You don't know where you are. It's easy just to forget all, completely forget about where I am or what I am. If there's no where, why do they need a what? So the best practice at any time, especially at this time in the world, where the world is getting, you know, extremely bizarre, indescribably bizarre, actually. I don't, just to say it doesn't deserve any explanation, any description. Indescribable doesn't, no description. The world is now just, let's just say, no description. We're giving no description when the world is gone into this, doesn't even deserve any description at all, then sitting quietly like this, what is it, getting used to identity without structure, getting familiar with it. It's just an exercise in willingness and discipline. So let's say Jesus walks by. I say, okay, I'm just going to still remain right here with identity as no structure at all. I'm not going to try to structure the experience Jesus walked by. I'm not going to try and structure that. What I am, there is no structure to I am. If there's no, if we don't need any answer, how can we get confused? We only get confused when we think that there's something we need to know, or supposed to know, structurally. Now, we might say, hey, no structure. What everybody else does? No, nobody has any structure. Just trying to let this develop here. The next step. If I have no structure, then how can I be someone else? I can't be someone else either, can I? I can't be identified by anyone, by any structure. So it's not just that this body is not me, it's that no bodies are me. No bodies are what I am. No body is what I am. I am free of all bodies, simultaneously. So it's not just getting free of like this body. It's getting free of all bodies. It's getting free of bodiness, structureness. So I am not anywhere. It's all these in the world with continuity theory who demanded that you identify with your body and as that is what you are. See, but We don't want to do that. We don't want to identify with anybody as what I am. Not this body, not any other body. Not this body in relationship to some other body at all. See? So not only is this body not my body, nobody is my body. I don't have any body, don't have any structure. So we don't need any I to claim it. There's nothing to claim it. There's no structure to claim no structure. There's no structure to claim no structure. We've heard this before, saying there's no I to claim enlightenment. There's no structure to claim no structure. How could there be? How could a structure say, hey, I have no structure? I'm claiming no structure. Well, <yes. laughs> this is what's been talked about in various teachings. You know, who's asking the question and who wants to know, and you know, like that. But how can a structure claim no structure? If something doesn't, I caught a glimpse of it, and it's just sort of, it's near, hovering near this insight. And okay, just let it hover near. It's fine. Don't be frantic about it. Act like you've been there before. Act like you have some poise. Act like you deserve it. You know, not like you're some criminal beggar, or trying to grab it. You know, like you don't deserve it. And I say, hey, I deserve all insight. So. It will come. It will show up. You know, and again, say, no, don't hire the world. Don't hire the world at all for anything. Say, nah, world, I'm no longer interested in hiring you, having you under my hire. Forget it. You know, it's. Don't have any value at all. You're not adding any value. I was thinking about, gotta get out of the Silicon Valley, you know, and thinking that the idea is, no, you can't leave. This is the best place. I said, really? I can't leave? Well, how much are you paying me to stay? That's the question. Say, flip it around. Say, hey, wait a minute. You're paying me how much to stay here? Talking to this area, the collective consciousness of the Bay Area. Hey, Bay Area, how much are you paying me to stay here? How much? I want to know. What's your payment for me to stay here? You see, I'm valuable. You know, I am is valuable, right? So you're paying I am how much to stay here? Again, how many, what, hundreds of millions, billions of dollars? You're not paying anything? In fact, I have to pay to stay here? Wait a minute, something's wrong with that equation. I have to pay to stay where I don't want to be. No, where I don't want to be. No. You have to pay. You have to, you know, you're not offering me anything. Then why should I stay? The world, is the world offering me something to stay here? And what is the world offering me to stay here? Well, what is the world paying me to stay here, to stay in the world, actually? No, it tells me I have to, you know, do all the payments to stay here. So, whoa, no, world. You got it all backwards. I am the Holy Son of God. I am is the Holy Son of God. I am is the Holy Son of God. We're all I am. We're all the Holy Son of God. I am is the Holy Son of God. And the world is paying us how much to, you know, reside here, to stay here? What is the world doing for us? I like to, you know, what is the offer? Come on, what's the offer? Well, here, let's see it, you know. Cards on the table. So turn it around on the world like that. Turn it around on the area that you're in. So you're in a certain area of the world. What area of the world? What are you paying me again? How much are you paying me again to stay here? To grace this area, this place with my, with I am? is the Holy Son of Godness. I'm greasing this, and what are you doing? So notice, put the area on the spot, flip the script. You're the one in charge. And of course, little answer, well, the payment's down the road when you finally succeed. You know, I can't really pay you now, but you'll be paid greatly in the future or something. That's always what they said, what a sin. And then say, well, you know what? I want payment now. Pay me now. You know, this sounds just like someone who can't pay anything and is just claiming that they'll get some money in the future, you know, get some payment for you in the future, but they're not getting anything. They can't get anything, so of course they're going to say, oh yeah, the pot of gold's at the end of the rainbow. That's where you'll find it. So just say, now how much are you paying me to stay here? I want the payment now. Where's the payment? I want to see the offer. What's the offer? The world says, well, if you just stay there forever and hopefully, you know, something will happen. You'll learn to love it. I don't need to learn to love anything. He says, you're the one who's trying to learn to love what I am. And so how much are you putting into it? Say that to the world. The world, you're the one who's trying to learn to describe me. How much you pay me for my modeling session here as you try to describe me and express me? How much? I don't come cheap. I don't come cheap. And the world get all defensive, all huffy and puffy. No, I don't come cheap at all, as a matter of fact. So I'm saying, hey, what's the contract here? Let's take a look at the contract here. I don't like the contract. I say, I don't want to stay here. I'm a free agent. You know, I'm a free agent. Just say, I'm a free agent. I'm always a free agent. And so I'm opening the bidding anew, you know, for my free agency, just like in baseball or sports. Become a free agent. You can go to every team in baseball can bid on you. Every team can meet with you, talk with you, say, here's what we are. We're going to offer you. So, hey, world, you know, I'm a free agent. There's lots of worlds in this cosmos, right? Lots of places. So, you know, what's your offer to me? Hey, the free agency period's coming to an end. You better make your offer or be left out. Make your offer, world, or be left out. I'm certainly not going to take no offer at all from a world. And you're asking me to, you know, hang out in this kind of situation so you can try to describe me, which, of course, I'm indescribable. So it sounds like a waste of time here. So, but first step, declare your free agency. Say, I'm a free agent now. I can go anywhere I want to go. I can live anywhere I want to live. I'll take the best offer. I'm open to offers. Who has the best offer? I say, hey, world, let's hear your offer because I'm getting lots of offers. So let's have your best offer now. What is your best offer? Put the pressure on the world. Don't let the world put the pressure on you. You put the pressure on the world. So I'm about ready to decide where I'm going to bring my value and talents. And if you want to be in consideration, you better make it very clear what you're offering me. So you're not a beggar. You don't go begging the teams. It's the teams that are begging for you. All these descriptions we call planets, and you know, these descriptions of essence, they're the ones who need essence to try and describe essence. Essence doesn't need any of these descriptions. They're the beggars. They're the beggars. They're the ones who are on their knees begging. They go, please, please, Spirit, we need you to be here so we can try and describe you. Yeah, like that. So just say, hey, what's your best offer? What's your best offer? Come up with your best offer right now, because I'm about ready. I'm ready to decide now. Make a decision. You've had plenty of long time to come up with an offer, and if you, maybe you're just incompetent, you can't do it. You don't have anything to offer. So come up with your best offer right now. So put the pressure on and insist on an offer right now, and then see what happens. Who can come up with an offer, actually? Not just stalling. See, full stop in the offer. Where is the offer coming from? Holy Spirit, the offer. You know. The real world, supernature, the real world vision of oneness right now. See, the Holy Spirit can immediately makes its offer. The others, they're still procrastinating, dragging their heels. Say, well, what do you want? What do you want? I want an offer. Show me the money. Show me the offer. That's what I want. Just like a baseball player will say, show me the contract you're offering me. How many years? How much money? It's very simple. How many years? How much money? All right? And the perks. But the basics, how much? Start the basics. What's your offer? And they can't just say, what kind of offer are you talking about? What are you in business? You don't even know what your business is. You're in the business of hiring baseball players for years and money. So what's your offer? You know, they keep playing dumb. You know, the world keeps playing dumb. That's all it can do. It doesn't have any offer at all that's any good for any for us or we would ever accept. None. So of course it plays dumb. Playing dumb is the world. Playing dumb. And then the guilt card. Oh, you didn't give me time. Oh, you didn't listen to my offer. You weren't willing to listen. You know, the dumb and then guilt. Dumb guilt. Yeah, but it's pathetic. They don't give us any. The world doesn't give us any offer at all. Well, it says, well, you're going to work here and die. You know, death is free. Everything else you have to work for. And you can, you know, work for... what does the world offer us? The body. And you know, that's its offer. The world offers this body. This dying body. That's its ultimate offer. A dying body. Of course it talks up the body. It thinks it has to describe spirit. It says, spirit, don't leave me. No, look at this body. This dying body is so wonderful. You can put new clothes on this dying body. Yeah. This rotting body. This is simply what the world is offering us. A timing device. Timing device, okay. Everything in this world is just a timing device. Spirit doesn't need any timing device. What does absolute freedom need a timing device for? Is freedom something that's timed? Is based on a timing device? Like, okay, you wait so long and then you're free. All form is really just timing devices. There's this whole world is just nothing but massive conglomeration of timing devices. What does spirit need timing devices for? So I don't need any. The world offers us here. Here's this rotting, dying body. It's a wonderful timing device. And then once it dies, then you can be spirit. You know, at the time. What I need the timing device for? I'm already spirit. It's like the gate's already open. What do you mean there's no timing device on the gate? It's already open. So I'm looking at the open gate, and all these, the world's trying to sell me all these timing devices to say, hold on to this, and when it's finally the time, then the gate will open. I said, what do you mean it's already open? I don't need any of these timing devices. Trees, plants, people, animals, everything. These are just timing devices. Forms. These forms are just timing devices. That's all they are. We don't even need to say bodies. Timing devices. So he says, your time will come. Don't worry, your time will come. I say, well, yeah, but why do I need a timing device? So we're just getting to the wow, getting used to the wow of this, a different way of describing form, everything that's happening. As this came to me this morning, just everything is just a timing device, like a timer on the gate. I say, well, you want me to pay attention to all these timers on the gate, with all these dimers on the gate, so all these dials, and say, okay, this one, it's like this massive, all these dials and stuff on the gate, and okay, this one reaches this point, and this one reaches this point. Timing devices. Why do I need to pay attention to the timing devices on the gate when the gate's already open? This is exactly what we're doing. We have our attention on all these timing devices. Is it my time yet? No. Everything is waiting for its time. And that's just on the gate. That's the timing devices. But the gate itself is open. These timing devices, like imagine a wrought iron gate. Maybe one that joins in the middle and swings open. A wrought iron gate swings open like that. And on both sides of this gate are just massive amounts of timing devices. Of all sorts, click, 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 clocks, you know, timing devices, like, this body has this amount of time, it's a timing device, bodies are, forms are timing devices, all these, we call animals, insects, they're all timing devices, actually, that's all they are, and so this world's like, this covered in all these massive amount of timing devices, for what? The gate's already open, the gate's already open, they say, no, structure will dissolve at this structure will dissolve at this point in time, and this one, and see, then it will be free of structure when it dissolves. I say, what are you talking about? The gate's already open. There's no structure. I'm seeing that my identity being has no structure. The dissolving of structure has nothing to do with what I am. The death of this body has nothing to do with what I am. It's just a timing device. It reaches a certain point and says, okay, now I'll dissolve the structure. Being what I am, is structure free. Right now, always, the gate's already open. So there's all this stuff, timing device is just a distraction. The world is just this massive distraction, actually. Don't look at the gate. Look at the open, that it's open. Not what's on the gate. All these timing devices. can foresee viewing it this way. You know, certainly it's possible. And with progress, that is possible. But we will stay with the wow now. But by staying with the wow, we get familiar with it. So familiarity, then, we know what the power of familiarity. The real power we should be seeking is the power of familiarity. Because that's what gets us there. So we're concerned about what gets us there. It's like you're driving a car somewhere. You can't be daydreaming about reaching your destination. Otherwise, you're going to crash. So you have to just be focused on where you are right now and just keep driving the car. You know, so the car is familiarity. Familiarity with the wow. Gates open. There is no structure. I don't have any structure. In fact, nothing actually has real structure at all. So what do I care about all these timing devices? It has nothing to do with what I am. I don't have to wait for any of these timing devices. I don't have to wait for this body to die. I don't have to wait for this body at all. Stop waiting on the body. Stop waiting on the body. Stop waiting on the body. Stop waiting on anybody. These timing devices are completely irrelevant. Just a trick. Self-deception. It's telling us that, well, we need to get used to both structure and non-structure. So you get used to being structure for a while, and then you'll be dissolved, and you'll experience non-structure for a while. That's duality, structure, non-structure. What we are has no structure. It's not a matter of non-structure. There is no structure. There's pure freedom. Pure freedom can never be structure. Can never be structure. So there isn't two realities we need to get used to. We don't need to get used to this body. We do not need to get used to this body. We do not need to get used to this world. At all. That's the booby prize. Because really this world is just timing devices. This tree there lasts so long, this bush, I can't see them now, but there, I know they're there. You know, shrubs, the house, the street, all these people, animals, and everything, you know, everything here, yeah, it lasts how long? You know, it's all being timed, isn't it? Timing device, it has a certain amount of time, we think. So, before its structure dissolves. And then say, okay, we're dissolved structure. No, we're not dissolved structure. Structure is inherently impossible for us. There's no issue of structure at all. Either structure or non-structure, no issue whatsoever. So we don't need the dissolving of our you know, timing device or anyone else's timing device. We don't have to wait for our dissolution. We don't have to wait for anyone else's dissolution. We don't have to wait for any dissolution at all. So now we're getting to the wow here. Dissolution anywhere whatsoever. totally valueless to us. Waiting for it has no value. Now, we can still be in the world, we're just not waiting for the world. We're not waiting for anything the world does at all. Doesn't mean we can't walk around the world, walk around this park, but not waiting for anything to happen at all. Not waiting for any dissolution at all. Not waiting for any births, not waiting for any deaths, not waiting for anything. Not waiting for any growth, any deterioration, not waiting for anything. We don't need to be like that dog is waiting for his owners to come back. The dog's barking, barking, barking. So upset, miserable. You know, we don't need to wait for the world. We don't need to wait for any dissolution or non-dissolution. So we don't need to wait anymore. That brings us right to not waiting, doesn't it? Which is where it's at. So this is such an unusual perspective. There's a wow. I don't know what will come of it. But it feels like, wow, this is tremendous. So often the wow is like you realize you made a breakthrough and you realize the ramifications are enormous. You don't have to wait. So you just full stop in the wow of this. At some point, you don't worry about trying to continue to develop the clarity of it. Once you reach a breakthrough, you realize you've done good work. Now it's a question of getting used to it. It's like you're exploring, and you finally come, the trail comes out, and there's the water, you know, there's a huge waterfall. At that point, it's just, wow, let me get used to this. This is really, really something. You don't think about retracing your steps. Now, how did I get here? Or now, how can I go get a bigger waterfall? No, you spent all this effort to come out, and here's this majestic, beautiful waterfall. Spend some time with it. Get used to it. This is where you're living right now. This is where you are right now. So, once you reached it, you realize you don't go backtrack and say, now, wait a minute, did it? No, where? How did I get here now? What steps did I take? You know, what the hell was I thinking? No, you're here already. So in the wow of it, so just experience the wow of it. Sometimes when the wow is so severe, It'll trick you into thinking now. You think, wow, it's not severe enough. I need to go back and make it a little more intense. Now, what was I thinking? How did I get here? That's a trick. Don't do that. If you're thinking that way, that means the intensity of the wow is just like, you know, almost too much to bear. The ramifications are so incredible that we're, you know, frightened of them. So just use your will to refocus on the wow, full stop in the wow. And just realize that the work is being done just as you sit there. The familiarity is taking place. That's the work. It's being done as you sit, as you focus. The work is getting done. It's kind of like a diet. Eat your soup at night. So that's it. Just the soup. So I'm sitting here like, you know, and I realize, you know, weight is being lost. For instance, I don't have to do anything. The weight is. I'm burning off calories just sitting here. So, familiarity is taking place just as you sit here. Full stop in the burn. Full stop in the wow. If you want a diet, just eat less and automatically you'll lose weight. You don't have to do anything else. So here, familiarity, automatically we get used to it. We don't have to do anything else. Get familiar with it. Don't have to wait on any description. Don't have to wait on any timing device. Timing devices are just descriptions, actually. Bodies are just descriptions. Form is just description. Time, space, process, form. These are all just descriptions, which is what? Structure, belief in structuring, structure. I don't need to wait on any description of what I am to be what I am. Do we need to wait on any description of what I am to be what I am already? Do we need to wait on some description? Why does what cannot be described need to be waiting on some description? Gate is already open. The gate to I am, which cannot be described, is already open. So why do we need to wait for a description? Not to open the gate, it's already open. Have your mind disengages, just still be patient. Just patient and just sit. Don't be in any hurry. And if the feeling of wow seems to be lost, don't try to re-engage with it by trying to remember what you just, you know, what you did before. That's how you really disengage from it. Don't do that. Just be patient. Just say, no, full stop. I'm not going to put any structure around it. Because what we're doing subtly is assessing our situation. Are we okay? So just give ourselves our subtle awareness time to assess the situation, having just made this huge breakthrough. Let it assess the situation, or lack thereof. See, the mind keeps saying, oh, what is it that you experienced? That's a trick. Just full stop in the wow. Don't describe it. Statement of truth. I don't know what I am. There is no what to it. So, there is no what. So, nothing can say what I am. I don't need to wait for anything to tell me what I am. There is no what. All this world is telling us what I am. So much what I am. Well, these time devices will supposedly tell us what we were. Well, this is what we were. There is no were to what I am. There's no what, there's no were. No what, no were to what I am. There's no cycle to what I am. No cycle of form and no form. No cycles at all. So why do I need to wait for any cycle? Why do I need to even wait an instant for any cycle at all? It has nothing to tell me. This world, whole world, has absolutely nothing to tell us. Zero. So we're waiting for zero. Why? We don't need to judge between various forms of zero. Big zero, little zero, what's the difference? Ragged zero, lopsided zero, smooth zero. It's all the same, zero. when we stop waiting for description, that's when we experience essence. How can we experience essence when we're waiting for a description of it? So you see, you get closer and closer and closer, and this is the continuity fear then kicks up. The wow kicks up. It's like, wow, this is very, very close. And then you try not to disengage with it. Is there any weight in essence? If you're waiting to experience waiting, if you want to experience waiting, how can you be aware of essence? There's no waiting in essence. It's seamless. Again, don't try to figure it out too much, you know. Stop, full stop in the wow. The wow is already there. Get this close, the wow is there. It's like, wow, I'm getting close. So honor that continuity fear. Instead of staying in your head, stay with the feeling more than in your head. The head's okay, the thinking is okay, but give more attention to the wow, the feeling of sort of staggered mind. More attention to that. Stay with that. Don't extrapolate. Well, I could do this, I could do this. That's inherently, we realize it, but don't start thinking about it. Just get used to exactly where we are right now. We're waiting for a description to be what? Accurate? And never is accurate. So what, we just simply wasted our time? Yes, absolutely. So we're going now into the Happy Hanukkah, Merry Christmas holiday season. So I wish everyone a Happy Hanukkah, Merry Christmas holiday season. Tomorrow's the 20th, I think. Yeah, 20th of December. So we're getting real close, aren't we? Getting real close. The start of 2:15. Very close. It'll be here before we know it. So we'll have a wait-free 2:15. Where we set the waiting down. See, we have to set the waiting down. There's never going to be an answer. There's never going to be a description. So we wait in vain. It's not like the waiting comes to an end because we succeed in defining ourselves. That never will happen. This is why I say the spiritual path has to be taken. Must be taken by all. The idea that, no, if we just wait long enough, the timing devices will, you know, it'll be our time to be defined. Never happens. So it's useless to wait until we succeed in defining ourselves. We have to realize that we have to decide not to wait anymore. Because we know we're waiting in vain. So we practice forgiveness of ourselves for having waited in vain for so long. You have a whole universe of waiters, just, you know, and so it's easy to get pulled into that. So forgive ourselves for getting pulled into it and you know, waited in vain. So don't agree with anyone's waiting. Don't say, no, they need to be waiting. No one needs to wait. No one needs to wait. So we don't need to see putting attention on these timing devices, what we call bodies and forms, to define anything for us. Spirit doesn't need to believe it's a body or identify with bodies or even see bodies as bodies. Again, Jesus says he sees himself as us, as these, as this great shimmering golden light extending forever. Doesn't see us as bodies. Doesn't see himself as a body. We don't need to see bodies. Those are just timing devices, mechanisms, attempts to define what we are. Belief that that what we are will be defined in time. You're defined in time. So all these timing devices are these promises of this will give you a definition here. This is a way of defining you. There are no ways of defining absolute freedom. So just getting used to this talk is very helpful. It will have benefit down the road a little ways. We may not be able to put it all together yet, but getting used to it. This is the whole key. Familiarity is the key. Get used to it, get used to it, get used to it. Get familiar with it. Get comfortable, relax. Say, oh yeah, this is familiar territory now. The more familiar the territory is, the easier it is to walk through it. You know, easily, you know, no problem. Once you've gone down a trail once, you know the turns and twists and turns, and you know where everything is. So the next time you go down it, you say, it's not any problem, not worried. It's easier, a lot easier. It's blazing the trail that is so difficult. But once you've done that once, easy to go the second time. Stay in this mood of like I'm just getting familiar with something. I'm not going to try to introduce anything else, you know, into my experiencing right now. just going to continue to pretty much do nothing for a while as I get the reverberations of this, get used to it. So the key is, after your life, you're making great progress like this, don't try to introduce a whole bunch of different elements into your situation. So I'm just gonna sit quietly, maybe on the computer, maybe look at YouTube, a few things here, maybe a song or something, but maybe just pretty much do nothing, as little as possible. Don't introduce anything intense after you've practiced, because you're letting yourself get used to what you just are going through. That's a very intense experience. Super intense experience. So on the path, you're going through super intense experiences, so you need to know how to wind it down and not. That's why I say monastic life is so helpful. Monastic culture is so helpful. You're going through super intense experiences like this, evaporating continuity fear. And afterwards, you just kind of need to just sit quietly, not do too much. Breakthroughs already happened. Now it's just a matter of accept the fact that breakthroughs did happen, and now I'm just in this getting used to it mode, that's all. And then drop all the attempts to remember how you did the breakthroughs, what the breakthroughs were, drop all that. Those already happened, and just be in this mode of settling down a little bit. So just stay in that mode. I'm going to try to stay in that mode. I feel a very strong spiritual buzz now, very strong. Trivial, inane stuff. I mean, don't try to introduce anything more heavy anymore. Once you've done the heavy lifting, time to take it easy. All right, take it easy. That's very great. That's it.